Kia ora, nau mai, haro mai. Good morning, church. We hope you have an awesome week. Let's praise our God this morning.
Up knowing there's a reason, all my dreams come alive, life is for living with you, I've made my decision, you lift me up, fill my eyes with wonder, forever young in your love, this freedom's untainted, with you, no moment is wasted. The sun now bursting through the clouds, black and white, turn to color all around. All is new, in the Savior I am found. This is living now. This is living now.
This morning, anyone thankful to be in the house of God? Anybody excited about what God is doing, what He wants to do in your life? Welcome, we're so excited you're here this morning. If you're visiting with us, we just want to say welcome. Thanks for being here. We'd love to connect with you after the service in our Connect Lounge. Now, we've got some great kids programs from our One and Walking right through to our intermediate program. Make sure you take avail of those services. Go out to the foyer. The team will take very good care of you. Our services are filling up at the moment, so if you can squeeze in and fill up the gaps, that'll be fantastic. So as people arrive, we can make room for everybody. Hey, we're singing a new song this morning. The words are, the church is alive. Jesus said He would build His church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We are the church. We are His people. The church is alive. And we're going to celebrate. We're going to be excited. We're going to lift our voices and praise Him this morning. So come on, let's sing with all of our heart and praise Him.
Hope erupting. Darkness shaking.
Come on.
Faith is rising. We know, we know, we know. Heart be racing. Living in your freedom. Joy overflowing. Freedom. what it sounds like. This is what it looks like. And this is what it feels like when the church is alive.
Come on!
This is what it sounds like. This is what it looks like. This is what it feels like when the church is alive.
You're alive and living today, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Lord God, your presence is overwhelming, God. We're in such an awesome place here with you, God. Thank you, Jesus. praise in this place. Just declare the goodness of God. Let our hope rise this morning. Jesus. You know, there's something pretty powerful about desperation. Desperation, I think, sometimes is a catalyst for faith. Sometimes there's a desperation that rises within our hearts. There's an anxiousness. There's a sense of, if I don't get something to happen now, I don't know what life will be like. And I look at the different passages in the Bible where Jesus had encounter with people, and there was a desperation that had risen within various people. The woman with the issue of blood, the Bible says she tried everything. She tried everything to no avail. She tried everything to get a breakthrough and a miracle, but nothing had happened. She pressed in. She says, if I can just touch the edge of Jesus' garment, I'm going to get my breakthrough. What about blind Bartimaeus sitting on the roadside? Jesus is going past him. Jesus isn't stopping at this moment. Jesus is going past him, and he cries out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. There was a desperation in him that says, I'm going to get my miracle. Desperation, I think, is so closely linked to faith. Last week we talked about the fact that our yes is God's promise. Our amen is the agreement to that promise. I didn't sleep last night. I rolled over and I think I might have popped the rib. Amy says, do you want to go to church or do you want me to MC? I said, no way. I'm going to church. I'm desperate for a miracle. I'm believing for a miracle this morning. And as we sing the song, Fullness, I want to encourage you, if you are desperate for something, if there is something you're believing for, step out in faith. I want to pray for some people. We're going to get the team to come forward. Step out in faith and expectation, because you know what? When God comes in his fullness, he doesn't hold anything back. He doesn't come in his fullness of love and leave his power behind. His fullness, there is healing, there is restoration, there is love, there is forgiveness. So whatever it is you are desiring, whatever it is you're hungering for, step forward in faith. Let's believe together for the miraculous, the signs and wonders to take place this morning. So come on, let's enter into God's presence, receive the fullness of his love this morning.
Come on, let's sing. Fullness of eternal promise, stirring in your sons and daughters, earth revealing heaven's wonders. Spirit come, what you spoke is now unfolding. All your children shall behold it. Dreams awaken in this throne. Spirit come, Spirit come. Come on, pour it out. Pour it out. Let your love run over. Here and now. Let your glory fill. Let your love run over here and now. to eternity. Do you believe it, church? And as we hold to this assurance, Spirit come, Spirit come, Spirit come, Spirit come, pour it out, let your love run over, here and now, let your glory fill this house, pour it out, let your love run over.
Just lift our hands to heaven this morning. You know, the lifting of hands is an act of surrender, saying, God, no longer me, not my own strength, but you and your power and your grace and your mercy. I just believe that this morning some people have stepped from their past into a new future. And I just want to declare over you that the old is gone, the new has come. God is more interested in your future than he is in your past. And that the prayer of confession, asking God to forgive you, to step forward into a new season, that old is gone. The accuser, his lies have no power over you anymore because you've been set free. He who the Son has set free is free indeed. If we confess our sins, the Bible tells us God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So you stand forgiven today, my friend. On your confession of faith, God has forgiven you because of what Christ has done. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, can we celebrate what God has done? We celebrate what God's done in your life. Let's lift up the name of Jesus in this place. Come on. Come on, let's praise him this morning. Let's praise and we thank you, Jesus. We thank you for healing. We thank you, God, for breakthrough. We thank you for restoration. We thank you, Jesus. You have set us free. Your freedom. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now at the end of the service, we'll give an opportunity if you want to receive further ministry. But isn't God good? Doing great things in our lives. Hey, before you sit down, why don't you say hi to somebody? Connect with someone. Maybe you've met them before. Invite them after the service for a coffee. Let's get to know somebody new today. Awesome. Maybe you met somebody new, someone you haven't met before. Take them into the Connect Lounge after the service and grab yourself a free coffee as well. If you're visiting with us, we just want to say a special warm welcome. We want to welcome you as our guests this morning. We've got the team down the front here. They're going to walk through the aisles with a gift. Got a booklet on who we are as Elim and a crunchy bar, a bit of chocolate. So if that's you, why don't you just wave your hand, flag the team down. They'll put it into your hand. Welcome this morning. Awesome. Great to have you here this morning. Anyone, just give us a wave. Fantastic. Come on, church, why don't we welcome our guests this morning? Awesome. That's great. Hey, we'd love to connect with you after the service. Why don't you head into the Connect Lounge and meet somebody new. Grab a free coffee on us. And we'd love to hear some of your journey and what God's doing in your life. Hey, we are one church across five locations. We are one here, one church, but we've got one here in Northland, we've got four in Auckland, and we sit under the leadership of Pastor Luke and Marilyn Bro, and we are just so excited to be a part of that one church. What we want to do this morning, Pastor Luke is having a birthday, all right? So we want to do a special happy birthday, so Amy's going to bring her phone, and it is a big 70. All right, so can we do a happy birthday? This is real spontaneous, so I don't know whether we can just get up on our feet and go, happy birthday! Come on, get on our feet. We can do that. Pastor Luke's turning 70.
Are you ready?
Are you ready? We love you, Pastor Luke. Happy birthday! Happy birthday! Fantastic. Well done. Hey, one of the things we love to do is we love to celebrate. And we celebrate weddings, wedding anniversaries, and birthdays. So if you've celebrated one of those, please come forward. We would love to celebrate with you. Come on up. Let's give away some chocolate. What are you celebrating? Awesome. That's great. Birthday. Yay. Birthday. Happy birthday, Mom. And a birthday. There you go. Doubles. 5 years. Congratulations. Well done. Mum's got a new job. Yay. Congratulations. Anyone else this morning? Nope. Fantastic. Right. Awesome. We're going to take up our offering this morning. In a couple of weeks' time, we have a missions offering that we're going to be giving to. We're going to show a video clip in a moment of Pastor Mike Griffiths, and he's just going to talk to what we're giving into. But those that faithfully give, you know, you return the 10% back to God. I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your obedience. Thank you for being faithful to God. You know, if you're visiting with us, please let the buckets go past. This is our gift to you. This is something we decide to do. We decide to do as believers to return to God that 10%, that tithe. So bless you, and watch the screens as the team take up the offering this morning.
So exciting that we are a church that is involved in such meaningful missions projects around the world that are having a huge impact. We are just back from Cambodia, where we were at the opening of the Hope Center. Now, a few years ago, we raised money to secure this land at a key junction in northern Cambodia. Today, through the work of Asian Outreach, Bruce and Diane Taylor, we've partnered with these guys. This center is extraordinary. It's reaching out into villages over the whole area. They're doing some of the smartest mission stuff I've ever seen. They're putting in wells and providing filters and latrines and getting kids to school and providing educational and vocational training. They're gathering pastors together and they're putting all of this through pastors and churches in each of these villages to connect everything through the gospel. It's totally inspiring. On top of that, we got to Chiang Mai to see the Invader office. A couple of years ago, we raised money so that Ralph Simpson and a team could go in there and be on the ground to see prosecutions of traffickers go through in that place. It's a beautiful office there. They've got an amazing team of social workers and investigators and lawyers. And in the last 12 months alone, over 70 traffickers have been put away through the work of Invader. The amazing thing is that that is 50% of all the trafficking convictions in Thailand in the last 12 months. Such an incredible work. Last year and this year, we're sowing into China. The work of the Drug Rehabilitation Center, the church there, establishing those, getting them sustainable. These are things that are going to touch generations. And once again, we get to be a part of what God is doing across the world. I can't encourage you enough to be a part of our missions offering coming up. It's an exciting season, and it's exciting to be able to see that God is using what we can sow to produce incredible results around the world. Let's give generously.
Fantastic. It's exciting, isn't it? 7th of May, going to be given into that. Wonderful. Hey, just a few notices. I'm really excited about Adrian. He's going to be preaching the message this morning. But just a couple of notices before he comes up. Welcome to the family. We are on a break. It is the fifth week of a month, so we're on a break this Sunday. But starting up next week, we start into our next growth course. Welcome to the family. If you're wondering what your next step is, this is your next step. You want to get involved, want to find out a little bit about who we are as a church, find out about who you are, how you're wired, how God's made you, and how you can get active, how you can get involved in our church, but also in the wider community, using your gifts to bless, to reach, serve, and influence our community around us. So that's so sign up at the information area for that. On the 28th of May, in our morning services, we are having child dedications. So if you would like to dedicate a child, it doesn't have to be a newborn. Maybe you haven't dedicated your child, you know, 5, 6, 7. We would love to be a part of that dedication on the 28th of May. So again, check in with the information booth and make sure you sign up for children's dedications. Make sure you stay in touch. We've got our different ways you can keep connected through our Facebook, Instagram, and also through email if you'd like to keep up to date with the church news. So before Adrian comes and shares, we've got an update on Alpha, only 4 days away, very exciting. So watch the screen, and then Adrian's going to come preach.
Nathan, it's good.
Hmm?
Nathan.
Yeah.
That food is for Alpha.
Mmm, I know, and it tastes awesome. It's good. Hey, everyone, Steve and I were just in the kitchen, finishing up the final menu items for Alpha. Can't wait to see you there Thursday at 6 p.m. Now, Steven, you've been to Alpha before, haven't you?
I have.
What was your experience like?
Well, experience was basically it prepared my heart for God. I had no trust, no willingness to engage with people. The two Alpha courses has given me new hope, new faith, a life with God, acceptance among the family and the church, and just all-round love. That's what it gave to me.
That's so cool. So thanks so much for sharing that with us, Stephen. And you out there, if you haven't invited someone yet, grab one of these from the information desk and take that step of faith. Who knows? They might say yes. Looking forward to seeing you there 4 days.
You made the heavens, the moon and the stars.
Hello, am I on? I'm on.
Great.
How are we doing, church?
Yeah.
Trying to get this thing in my back pocket. It's proven awkward. Hey, apologies, Mike. I had a great night's sleep last night. Turns out my bed at home works out way better with one person than four people. My in-laws, Abby's parents, have shouted her and the kids a trip to Aussie to go see them. So that's been pretty cool. So they're away for 2 weeks. I did have dinner last night, thanks to my friend Uncle Ben. He's a great guy, and he made dinner in 90 seconds. Unbelievable. More time for Xbox, I say. Anyways, we're going to preach this morning. Anybody ready for the message? Come on. Hey, we're preaching the second part of our Search for Meaning series, which is great. If you missed last week's message, Pastor Mike preached a great message, so make sure you get online and get there. But we're going to pray and get into it. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Two people are cool praying. Okay, awesome. God, we just thank you that you're awesome. God, we love you. God, we thank you for your word, for your truth that speaks to us, that leads and guides us. And God, I pray that this message, God, would be more than just words, God, but it would be something that would impact our heart, God, that would transform the way we live. In Jesus' name. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Hey, Pastor Steve at our East congregation, he preached a great message on this. And so I grabbed some of his notes and sort of used as a foundation for my message. And I think it's really good. So I'm going to talk on the second part of our series, looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 2. And it's an interesting passage or interesting chapter. And Solomon is really seeking. He's seeking for fulfillment. He's searching for meaning in life. And I've subtitled this message, The Pursuit of Happiness. The Pursuit of Happiness, because I think that's how we can summarize what Solomon is doing here. And let's be honest, we all want to be happy. Anybody here want to be happy? Three people being honest, awesome. You know, every one of us, in some shape or way or form, want to be happy. You know, we've all said something like, or heard someone say something like, you know, if it's okay, if it makes you happy, or as long as you're happy, or you deserve to be happy, or if you're okay with that, if that makes you, you know, we've all said something like that. We're all, in some way, shape, or form, we want to be happy. We want to have some sort of happiness out of life. And often in searching for meaning in life, we search for something that will bring us fulfillment. We search for something that will bring us enjoyment, maybe, contentment. We search for something that will bring us satisfaction. Or maybe we could summarize those things the same. We search for something that will bring us happiness. Am I right? You know, I remember in my late teenage years, this was me. I was trying to find out what life was all about. I was trying to find out what I was here for, what everything was about. And so I began to look at what my friends were doing. I began to look at what the people around me were doing. And I began to search for meaning. I began to search for contentment, began to search for something that would fill me. And but the more I try to fill my life with stuff, the more I began to fill my life with relationships and different things, actually the more empty I became. The more I found that I was missing something, the more I found that something wasn't quite right. And I find it fascinating that Solomon looks to these same things. Solomon tries to find fulfillment. Solomon tries to find happiness in these same ways that we do today. It was just on a bigger scale. And I'm going to read a little bit from Scripture and you'll see what I mean in a second. And so chapter 2 is there in your notes, but I'm going to sort of summarize it just a little bit and pick out the highlights so we get a sort of picture of what Solomon's life was all about. We ready?
Yeah.
So reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 2, and this is from the New Living Translation. This is what Solomon says. He says, I said to myself, come on, let's try pleasure. Let's look for the good things in life. He goes on to say that I try to cheer myself with wine, and while still seeking wisdom, I built huge homes for myself and planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks, filling them with all kinds of fruit trees. I built reservoirs to collect the water to irrigate my many flourishing groves. I bought slaves, both men and women. I owned large herds and flocks, more than any of the kings in Jerusalem who had gone before me. I collected great sums of silver and gold, the treasure of many kings and provinces. I hired wonderful singers, both men and women, had beautiful concubines, I had everything that a man could desire, it says. So I became greater than all those who had lived in Jerusalem before me, and my wisdom never failed me. Anything I wanted, I could take. I denied myself no pleasure. Sounds pretty fabulous, doesn't it? I even found a great pleasure in hard work, a reward for my hard labors. But as I looked at everything I'd worked so hard to accomplish, it was all so meaningless, like chasing the wind. There was nothing really worthwhile anywhere. Here's a man who literally had everything and anything he could ever want. Like, this is not Solomon being cocky. This is him just giving an accurate picture of what was going on. Like, this was what he had. He had everything he could ever wanted. But still he found that those things didn't satisfy. He found that those things didn't satisfy. You know, in this passage, I believe that we see six ways that he tried to find satisfaction. Six things that he used to try and find meaning in life. And it's the same things that we still use today. He pursued happiness, first of all, in education. You know, some people think that, you know, if only I could get that degree, if only I could get that master's, if only I could get that PhD, if only I could simply just know more, then my life would be satisfying. Then I would find happiness. Then I would get the job that I wanted. But it says that Solomon was wiser than anyone in Jerusalem that had gone before him. Yet he didn't find satisfaction in that. He tries to find satisfaction in pleasure or experiences. The drinking of wine, parties, fine things in life, music. The Bible says that he withheld himself no pleasure. He withheld himself no pleasure, and he had access to whatever he wanted. You know, sometimes we think that, you know, if only we could do those things that we know the Bible says that we shouldn't, then we'll be happy. If only we can experience all kinds of things. You know, people today are just looking for experiences. They're going traveling. They're going bungee jumping, skydiving, all kinds of crazy experiences to try and find fulfillment, to try and find satisfaction. Yet these things didn't satisfy him. Even hard work. He didn't abstain from hard work. He even worked hard. And sometimes we think, if only I could get that promotion. If only I could get that business to the next level. If only I could get that other business. If only I could get those accolades, get that award at work, then I will find fulfillment. Then I'll find happiness. But yet he found that even that didn't bring fulfillment. I know this is super encouraging. Really encouraging. Money. Sometimes we think, if only, how many of us have been there, but if only I had a little bit more money. If only I had just enough, if only I could buy that house, if only I could just get that new car, if only I just had just enough money to get by, then everything would be okay. Then my life would be radically different. Then I would be satisfied. Then I would be happy. Yet Solomon had more than enough. He had crazy amounts of money. It did not satisfy. Sexual relationships, we think that, you know, if we engage in sexual relationships, that's where we'll find happiness. That's where we'll find pleasure and fulfillment. And I think Solomon's a little bit of an expert on this case. Bible says that he had 700 wives and 300 paid mistresses. I'm not quite sure how he needed that many. Well, I mean, like, just simply doing the maths with 365 days in the year. Like, I don't. But he said that still didn't find fulfillment. Success. The Bible says that he became greater than anybody that had ever gone before him. Sometimes we think that if we simply just have success, if we become famous, if we make a name for ourselves, if we get people to know us and notice us, then we'll find fulfillment. or find happiness. But even that, it says that Solomon became greater than anybody that had gone before him. Yet that still didn't satisfy. You see, we see that and think that surely a guy like this would be the happiest guy in the world, right? Like he had everything he ever wanted. Surely he would be happy. But after attaining and chasing after all these things, he describes it as meaningless, like chasing the wind. If even Solomon describes it like this, then probably if we were chasing after these same things, we wouldn't find happiness either. And so then, how do we find happiness? What brings happiness? Good thing for us is that Jesus taught us how to find happiness. Jesus shows us in Scripture in Matthew chapter 5. Because, you know, we can all fall into that trap of thinking the same things will make us happy. We can all think that money, success, sex, pleasures, education, work, all these things will bring us happiness. If simply we had more of one or all these things, that we would find contentment. But the reality is that we won't. You know, if you talk to anybody that was some sort of addict or some sort of alcoholic or successaholic or workaholic or whatever, they would tell you that the things that they thought would bring them happiness was actually the thing that revealed that they were empty. Was actually the thing that they brought emptiness, that brought that dissatisfaction with life. The question then is, if these things that most of us, we could say, or most of the world would spend their time chasing after, if these things won't make us happy, then what will? What will? And Jesus actually gives us, as I said before, a recipe for true happiness. It's found in the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. And the passage outlines 8 key attitudes or characteristics or practices that will help us to have a fruitful pursuit of happiness. A fruitful pursuit of happiness. And we're going to look at those things. And unfortunately, due to time, I'm going to be skimming over those things. But I really encourage you, if something jumps out at you, if something stands out, highlight it, write a note, scribble on it, and sit on it. Think about it. Go back to it later. Ask God to bring some insight. And I believe that it's going to be a key breakthrough point for you. Let's read together, and it'll be up on the screens. Matthew chapter 5, starting at verse 3, says this: "Happy are those who know they are spiritually poor. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Happy are those who mourn. God will comfort them. Happy are those who are humble. They will receive what God has promised. Happy are those whose greatest desire is to do what God requires. God will satisfy them fully. Happy are those who are merciful to others. God will be merciful to them. Happy are the pure in heart. They will see God. Happy are those who work for peace. God will call them his children. Happy are those who are persecuted because they do what God requires. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Happy are you when people insult you and persecute you and tell you all kinds of evil lies against you because you are my followers. Be happy and glad, for a great reward is kept for you in heaven." That's pretty encouraging. You know, if you want to pursue true happiness, number one, you've got to get to know God. You've got to get to know God. How happy are those who know they're spiritually poor? You know, we could say that another way. They're happier those who know their need for God. You see, without God, we're spiritually poor. I don't know if you realize, but you're actually a spiritual being. You see, the world will try to tell us that all we are is matter and atoms and flesh, and we're just some sort of scientific coincidence. But the reality is that you're not a scientific coincidence. Actually, you are the result of a creator, of a designer, of a God who loves you and has created you with a purpose, who's created you with a plan. The real hunger that is inside of you is not a hunger for stuff. In fact, it's a hunger for a relationship with God. And often we try and fill it with other stuff, but actually the only thing that will fill it is a relationship with God. You see, there's a God-shaped void or hole or gap in your life. And many have felt that. I know that I felt that as I was searching for something in my early or late teenage years. And you can try and cover it up. You can try and fill it with a whole bunch of stuff. But actually the reality is that the only thing that will fulfill is a relationship with God. Is knowing our Creator. That's the only thing that truly satisfies. And so if you really want to have true happiness, the first thing you need to do is you need to get to know God. You need to spend some time with Him. You need to get into His Word. You need to start talking to Him through prayer. Number two, we need to trust God when life is disappointing. We need to trust God when life is disappointing. Happy are those who mourn, for God will comfort them. You see, the truth is that life is a combination of pleasure and pain. Good times and hard times. If you've been on earth for any length of time, I'm sure you've experienced an aspect of this. I'm sure you've experienced good times and bad times. Hard times, tough stuff. You see, if you need to live a problem-free life in order to be happy, unfortunately, the bad news is that you never will be. You see, if our happiness is reliant on circumstances, if our happiness is reliant on the people around us or the things that are happening around us, then actually we won't be happy, because life happens. Stuff happens. Bad things happen. But if we want to be happy, actually we need to trust God to comfort us in those hard situations. We need to trust God even when life doesn't go our way, even when life is disappointing. You see, when you're hurting, mourning, doing it tough, we can let God handle it. And in fact, that in the midst of the biggest storm, we can experience peace. You see, when we trust God for our comfort, we trust God to give us peace, that no matter what's going on around us, we can experience God's peace in the midst of a storm. The Bible says that the peace of God surpasses all understanding, that we don't need to be anxious for anything, but we can express all our needs to Him, and His peace will guide our hearts and minds. Come on, if we want to experience true happiness, we need to trust God, even when it doesn't make sense. We need to trust God when life is disappointing. Number three, if we want to experience true happiness, we need to expect God to meet our needs. We need to expect God to meet our needs. Happy are those who are humble. They will receive what God has promised. You see, rather than living a self-centered life where we're trying to grab at everything, when we're trying to just get ahead and do whatever it takes to find our own happiness, actually we need to trust God. We need to choose to be dependent on God, not independent on ourselves. We need to trust God to provide for our needs, to give us what we need. You know, in the first 11 verses of chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes, Solomon uses the words my, mine, myself, or I 34 times. Wow. 34 times. And we know that Solomon was a godly man sort of overall, but in this period of his life, we can see that he's strayed away from godly wisdom and he's trying to find the answers within himself. He talks about my success, my happiness, my health, my harem, my money, my pleasure, my education, my success. And it's incredibly self-centered. And because of this, he can't find fulfillment. I don't know if you've ever known a self-centered person, but I've never met one that's happy. You know, we don't find happiness through being self-centered. We find happiness through putting God in the center. If we want to live a life of true happiness, we need to expect God to meet our needs. Number four, if we want to experience true happiness, we need to follow God's instruction. We need to follow God's instruction. Happy are those whose greatest desire is to do what God requires. God will satisfy them fully. You see, when you align your life with the Word of God, then you align yourself to live the best life you can. It's sort of like going on a train track. You know, when we allow ourselves to be guided by the rail, we end up in the destination that we need to be. But sometimes we decide, oh, we're just going to go off the rails, you know? We're just going to do whatever we want. But actually, unfortunately, it ends up worse. I think some people think that God's some sort of big fun sponge, you know, that he just wants to suck up all the fun. And he gives us the Bible as like the fun sponge recipe. But the reality is actually that God loves us, that actually he wants the best for us, that actually living by God's word is the best way that we can live. It'll bring freedom, it'll bring fulfillment, it'll bring destiny, it'll bring everything that we need. And we need to recognize that and realize that. I know that I'm going through these real fast this morning, but hopefully you're getting some good stuff. And I encourage you, as I said, if one of these things is jumping out at you, why don't you highlight it or write a note and come back to it later. You know, the fact that Solomon summarizes, it's like he comes to terms and he realizes what everything's about, and he summarizes the book of Ecclesiastes like this. He says, here now is my final conclusion. Fear God and obey his commands. For this is everyone's duty. Fear God and obey his commands. In other words, have a reverence for God. Honor God. Put him in first place and do what he says. That's what everyone should do. That's what it's all about. When, in a summary of life, having experienced probably more than anybody in maybe creation will experience again, having everything he could ever want, He says, fear God and do what he says. I think that's good advice. Number five, cultivate a forgiving heart. Cultivate a forgiving heart. Happy are those who are merciful to others. God will be merciful to them. You see, forgiveness is one of the most toxic poisons that exists. You know, we hold on to unforgiveness, actually it poisons ourselves. We think that unforgiveness, when we don't allow someone to be free, we think that it's like drinking poison and expecting them to be hurt. But the reality is the only one that gets poisoned is us. The only one that is hurt is us. We often think to ourselves that, you know, if that person gets what they deserves, or if they get what's coming to them, or if they simply just apologize, then it'll be okay. But the realization is actually when we receive that, actually it's not okay. Is that we're still sitting with that stuff. See, the only way that we get free, the only way that we experience true happiness is when we live a life that is forgiving, when we live a life that is light. You see, it's impossible to go through life without people hurting you. It's impossible to go through life without somebody offending you or someone saying something or someone looking at you funny. But it's our choice how we respond. It's our choice how we... And I know there's some stuff that's really hard and I'm not minimizing those things, but we need to come to a point where we can forgive, when we can release people and say, it's okay, that thing that you did to me, you don't owe me anything anymore. You know, forgiveness is not about saying it's okay. It's about saying that they no longer owe you anything. It's actually about getting yourself free. It's about getting yourself free. The Bible, in fact, says that if we don't forgive others, God can't forgive us. That's pretty full on. If we want to pursue true happiness, we need to cultivate a forgiving heart. Number six, we need to maintain a clear conscience. Happy are the pure in heart, for they will see God. You know, guilt destroys happiness. Guilt destroys happiness. When we have that fear inside of us of getting caught or being found out, these things that are just sitting with us that we can't get rid of. When we have that, we can't experience true happiness. The happiest people, those that live with integrity. Those that live lives that are transparent, that what you see is what you get. You know, if you live a life with integrity, and you live with a pure heart, that's when we experience God's joy, His happiness. And maybe this morning there's someone that you need to talk to. There's someone that you need to get right with, or a conversation that you need to have, or someone that you just need to get alongside of and say, I need some help in this area. Come on, when we live lives that are transparent, that's when we can experience God's happiness for our lives. That's when we can live light. If you want to experience true happiness, you need to maintain a clear conscience. Second to last point, number seven, you need to build healthy relationships. Build healthy relationships. Happy are the peacemakers. You see, conflict also destroys happiness, and we need to be the ones that work hard to build healthy relationships. Be quick to solve issues. You know, I found that there's a difference between being a peacemaker and a peacekeeper. Often I like to play the position of peacekeeper. You know, rather than engaging in the conversation, I just sort of let it slide. You know what I mean? You know, trying to keep the peace. And I know that I shouldn't. I know that there's an issue and really I should just go address it. But I thought, oh, you know, like it'll sort itself out. How many of us know that it never sorts itself out? Actually, the difference between being a peacemaker and a peacemaker actually actively works to make peace. It means you actually have to engage in the conversation. It means you actually have to have those tough conversations. Let it get a bit awkward sometimes. But actually that helps us to maintain peace. Because often we don't go address the situation and it never really gets better, does it? Like we live in a world where things just decline. And so it gets worse. And so actually we have to work to maintain peace. We actually have to have those conversations. We actually have to engage in the situations that we really don't want to. I'm preaching to myself here. Probably none of you guys have that issue, but I do. It's okay. We need to work to maintain peace. And as I close, I'm going to invite the band to come up with the keys. Last of all, live with eternal perspective. Live with an eternal perspective. Happy are those who are persecuted because they do what God requires. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You know, we live in a finite world, you know, within space and time, and it can be really hard to understand or to grasp that there's something more to this There's something more than just this. That there's an eternal world out there, that God is beyond space. We can't get that. Maybe people like me can't get that. Some people can understand it because they're smart. But sometimes we get so caught up in living life and the day-to-day that we forget that we should have an eternal perspective. That one day we'll pass from this life and we'll spend eternity with God. And we begin to look at just the here and now. You know, sometimes with all these things, when we simply just take ourselves outside of the picture and look at the bigger perspective, actually a lot of it just makes so much more sense. Actually, those decisions become a lot easier. Actually, those decisions become a lot simpler and less complicated. You know, don't just look at the here and now. A tremendous reward awaits you in heaven. You know, Apostle Paul said, don't give up doing what is right. Don't give up doing what is good. Keep pressing on. Keep running your race, and in due time, come on, there's a reward that awaits you. As we finish, you know, Solomon, the wealthiest man who ever lived, the wisest man who ever lived, if he couldn't find fulfillment in pursuing those things, if he couldn't find fulfillment in pursuing wealth and education and money and sex and relationships and all those kinds of things, then why should we pursue those things too? And I know that sometimes we get caught up in pursuing those things and think that those things will bring us happiness. And you know, even as Christians, we do those. And I'm going to ask everyone to stand, and I want to begin to pray into all those situations. Come on, let's stand together right now. I want to pray into all those situations, those points that I talked about. And you don't have to put up your hand or anything. You just have to agree with me in your heart. Because I know that all of us at some point have wrestled with these things, have struggled, have chased after these things. And so I'm going to begin to pray that God will help us to find true happiness. Is that cool? Come on, let's close our eyes. God, we just thank you that you are such a gracious God. You're such a loving God. You're such a forgiving God. And God, I pray for those of us that need to get to know you, God. That maybe have been walking into church for a long time, but God, never have experienced a real relationship with you, God. I pray that, God, this week, God, today, in this moment, God, you would simply come alive to them, God. God, you would reveal yourself to them, God, that they would begin to have a new hunger and desire, God, for your word, for prayer, God, for worship, God, for getting to know you, God. God, I pray for those that are dealing with situations that are disappointing. God, I pray for those that are going through stuff that is tough, God, and they don't know what to do or where to turn, God. And those that are right now, God, either walking in or walking out of or walking through, God, a storm, God, would you bring peace? I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you do bring peace. And God, would you bring peace to their lives, God? God, would you bring peace to their families? God, would you encourage them with a word, God? Would you encourage them with people coming around them, God? Would you help them to walk through that storm unscathed, God? God, I pray for those that have needs, God, or those of us that are struggling to grasp different things. God, would you help us to trust you to meet our needs, God? I thank you, God, that in you, God, we have more than enough, God, that you are a shepherd, God, that you provide us all that we need. God, help us to trust you for that. God, help us to understand your word and follow it, God, to put you in first place, God. God, help us to cultivate, God, a forgiving heart. God, I just pray for those that are struggling, God, to forgive. Maybe a loved one, maybe a family member, maybe someone else that has hurt them, God, that has betrayed them, God, that has broken their trust. God, I pray you'd help them to forgive. Pray for someone that's been abused, God, for someone that has had words spoken over them, God, that has brought death, God, I pray that you'd bring life, God. God, would you bring healing, God? God, would you help them to cultivate? God, would you help all of us, God, to cultivate a forgiving heart? God, I pray for those that has got something weighing on our conscience, God. God, would you help us to get a clear conscience, God? God, would you bring people around us, God? God, would you help us to confess to one another and be healed, as your word says, God. God, would you help us to build healthy relationships? God, would you help us to be peacemakers, God? God, I pray for those that maybe have right now that there's a situation or a person that's being highlighted to them, God. God, would you help them to have the boldness and the confidence to go and enter into that conversation, God? Would you help them to have the boldness and the confidence, God, to go and make things right with that person? And last of all, I want to pray for those that are here and they don't yet have an eternal perspective. You don't yet have a relation with God. You haven't started a journey with Him. Let me tell you that the only way that you can find fulfillment in life is through a relationship with God, with Jesus, with your Creator. We've all messed up, we've all made mistakes, we've all sinned against God. But the beauty of the gospel, the beauty of the good news, the beauty of the Bible is it teaches us that Jesus came and He lived a perfect life and died a criminal's death on the cross to pay for our mistakes, to pay for our shortcomings. And all we have to do, the Bible says, is choose to turn from that old life, choose to invite Jesus into our life and place Him in first place and choose to follow Him. And so if that's you this morning, why don't you just pop up your hand right where you are? I don't want to pray a simple prayer with you to help you invite Jesus into your life, to start a journey with Him. So I'm going to count to three, and if that's you, pop up your hand and I'm going to pray a simple prayer with you. 1, 2, 3. Awesome, let's pray. God, we just thank you, God, that we can have eternal life with you. God, we recognize that we've made mistakes. We recognize that we've sinned. We recognize we can't do it alone. And Jesus, we thank you that you died on the cross for our sins. Right now we pray and ask that you would come forgive us. We choose to start a new life with you today. Would you make us new, Jesus? In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Awesome, church. Awesome. Hey, as I said before, if something stood out to you, why don't you go sit on it? Why don't you go talk to someone about it? Why don't you pray about it? Why don't you ask God to bring you insight? And I know that God will. And if you started a relation with God, if you prayed that prayer for the first time or maybe for the 10th time, there's a team at their back with some white bags that say, I've decided. Why don't you go grab a bag and get to know God. Get into your Bible. If maybe you don't have a Bible, go grab a Bible. Because that's the way that we find true life is through God's Word. Come on, we're gonna praise. We're going to finish our praise song. Is that cool? Come on, let's go, man.
Message from Pastor Adrian.
This is the end of our service. Make sure you grab an Alpha invite. You know somebody who needs Jesus? I think we all do. So come on, this band's going to sing us out. Have a fantastic week. Love having you here. Let's continue to just reach, serve, and influence our community. Amen? Come on, Tim.
See the sun now bursting through the clouds, black and white, to the color all around. All is new in the Savior I have found. This is living now. This is living now.
See you all next week, 10 a.m. God bless.